Hi everyone. In continuation of the genus Clostridium, today I am going to talk on one more organism, that is Clostridium botulinum, which is a most important disease botulism produced by this organism through the production of a potent toxin. So here we have a brief note on the case history. A 2-year-old baby was admitted in the pediatric ward of a hospital with weak cry and severe muscle weakness. On evaluation of case, mother told that baby is being fed with honey. This is only little history saying that this is the disease transmitted or disease produced by the consumption of certain types of foods. So the organism to be discussed with this little case history is the Clostridium botulinum, which is an important organism which would be transmitted through an important substance like honey. So this Clostridium botulinum is a gram positive bacilli with the subtechnal spore. On right side you can see the schematic diagram. And before going for the other factors, let me talk about the botulinum toxin, which is most potent toxin. The lethal dose for human being is around 350 micrograms, and its protein, which is heat stable but inactivated at 80 degrees centigrade for about 30 minutes, and it would be released as prototoxin. And this prototoxin, once you consume through the contaminated food, it mixes with some of the enzymes in the stomach and gets activated to form the toxin. And this toxin has got the two subunits, A and B. The A subunit is a neurotoxin and B prevents the acid inactivation of A chain of this particular toxin. It has got 8 antigenically different toxins like A, B, C1, C2, D, E, F, G. Among them, C2 is most powerful toxin, and this toxin is designated as Bont A or Botox or something like that. And mechanism of action of this botulinum toxin, after the infection, this toxin would be produced, and the toxin enters to the neuromuscular junction through the vascular system and reaches the postganglionic parasympathetic nerve endings and peripheral ganglia. And once it reaches to that particular areas, it binds to the acetylcholine receptors at neuromuscular junction and cause for blockade of release of acetylcholine, which finally leads to the muscle paralysis due to hypotonia. The type of paralysis produced by this particular toxin is known as flaccid paralysis. This paralysis is due to lack of acetylcholine to contract the muscles. And see, this mechanism of action will be depicted like this. If you see this particular slide, which shows the normal neurotransmitter release, how muscle will get contracted. So on left side and corner, you can see the neuromuscular junction with motor neuron ending and muscle cell. And a small area of that particular neuromuscular junction has been magnified here and followed by the electrical stimulus. These are the processes which will occur at the neuromuscular junction. Followed by the electrical stimulus, the snare proteins which are present in the nerve terminus, the snare proteins like synaptobrevin, SNAP25 and syntaxin, all these snare proteins will combine with the synaptic vesicles and forms the snare protein and synaptic vesicle and snare protein complex. And this complex only can bind to the nerve terminus to release the acetylcholine to the neuromuscular junction. So only synaptic vesicles in the normal condition can't release the acetylcholine, And so when the electrical stimulus occurs, the stair proteins will combine with the synaptic vesicles, and this complex only can get fused with the nerve terminus, releases the neurotransmitter, that is acetylcholine, and it acts on its own receptors and cause for the muscle contraction. This is the normal muscle contraction. But what will happen in case of toxicity or a toxin with botulinum, we will see now. So here, after exposure to the botulinum toxin, this toxin gets endocytosed, and by means of endocytosis, it will be taken into the nerve terminus. And here, this botulinum toxin can be divided into two chains. One is light chain and heavy chain. And this light chain cleaves the snare proteins, which I have shown in the previous slide. It will cause for the destruction or damage to the snare proteins. Once the snare proteins gets damaged, the fusion of the synaptic vesicles with snare proteins will not occur. If this fusion won't occur, then the synaptic vesicles won't release the acetylcholine, and then the neurotransmitter will not be released, that is acetylcholine will not be released, and finally results in lack of muscle contraction, finally results in paralysis, flaccid paralysis. Even though we are giving the stimulus to the muscles, it won't get contracted because of non-fusion of the snare proteins with the synaptic vesicles, which is a most important step in release of acetylcholine. This is how the botulinum toxin will act. And of course, if you see the disease botulism produced by these organisms, in US, out of 145 cases reported, 15% were foodborne. And the high mortality associated with infant botulism. Of course, this case is also seen in India. And these cases are commonly occurs with the home canned foods, which are improperly canned home preparations are responsible for this kind of disease. And after an incubation period of 18 to 36 hours, the people will succumb to the severe clinical manifestations, which will be discussed later. And the most important differential diagnosis for the botulism is Guillain-Barré syndrome. You know that, I think you all of you know what is Guillain-Barré syndrome. This is an autoimmune disease which is due to the attack of autoantibody on the nerve cell. Usually our own cells will be attacked by our own antibodies and which are called autoantibodies. And this autoantibody mediated disease is Guillain-Barré syndrome, which mainly affects the peripheral nerves. Nothing will happen to the central nervous system in this condition, but the peripheral nerves will get paralyzed, and results in all muscles gets paralyzed because of damage to the peripheral nerve endings. And another differential diagnosis for this botulism is stroke and myasthenia gravis. Myasthenia gravis is also another autoimmune disease where the autoantibodies are produced against acetylcholine receptors. And so in this case, death may occur within a week or slow recovery may be possible over months. And the pathogenesis of botulism, there are four varieties of botulism are there. One is foodborne botulism, mainly through the home canned meat and vegetables and fish. So the people will store all these food items thinking that they are safe. But the improper canning of the meat or certain other vegetables and meat products may result in contamination with this bacteria, which produces the toxin. And if you consume the food along with the toxin, we can suffer with the disease. Another thing is wound botulism is possible due to the contamination of wound with Clostridium botulinum. And infant botulism, Rarely, adult botulism also possible through the consumption of honey. So, ingestion of contaminated food like honey results in infant botulism. So, that's why whenever you are storing the honey, you have to keep it in a proper environment. Otherwise, if you are buying the honey bottles, better to buy the small bottles with small quantities. Otherwise, while you are handling every day, it may get contaminated to the spoons which are being used, or any other thing being used to transfer onto our glass or something. That's why the honey has to be taken in small bottles, because the contamination of honey with this bacteria results in infection. And one more thing is, honey is a very good anaerobic medium for the growth of this bacterium, so they can grow very happily in that, and it causes for the infection. Next one is iatrogenic botulism, that is by means of overdosage of botulinum toxin results in this kind of botulism. So you may be hearing about the Botox treatment for facial muscles and all. And if you give this, not only for that, for certain other conditions also, medically also, not only for the cosmetic purpose, medically also this botulinum toxin would be used in certain neurological conditions. And these situations, the overdosage of toxin may occur, results in disease manifestations. And the clinical presentation of botulism, this would be in three forms: foodborne botulism, infantile botulism, and wound-borne botulism. If you see the foodborne botulism, the people may suffer with blurred vision with fixed and dilated pupils, which may appear as a first sign in the infected individual, and drooping of eyelids, and difficulty in swallowing, that is dysphagia, and constipation, difficulty in bowel motion may occur. Urinary retention will be there, and in spite of all these manifestations, patient is alert and oriented. And this foodborne botulism in adults is associated with 10 to 25% mortality. And infantile botulism, the main source is honey. Commonest age group is less than 6 months of age. Of course, it's possible even 2-3 years also. The people will suffer, or babies usually suffer, with poor feeding and weak cry. You can see the photographs below, how the baby is suffering with weak cry, and loss of head control will be there. That also will be shown in another photograph, when the person trying to hold the baby, the baby is not able to hold his head. And this is again due to the flaccid paralysis. And wound-borne botulism, this is very common among the chronic drug abusers. Because of the contaminated syringes, this bacteria will enter and cause for the disease. And followed by the caesarean section also, this wound-borne botulism is possible. But clinical manifestations appear like a foodborne botulism, except the gastrointestinal symptoms. Gastrointestinal symptoms won't be there, but other things are definitely present in these particular individuals. And laboratory diagnosis, the demonstration of toxin is having utmost important modality in the diagnosis. We have to collect food, I mean suspected food, the feces from the patient, vomitus from the patient, serum from the patient has to be taken. And with this, by means of ELISA method, we have to estimate the toxin, and based on the toxin, we have to come to conclusion that the cause for the disease. And another thing is, serum toxin biopsy also can be done by using an experimental animal, that is mice. And neutralization test in the mice with polyvalent antitoxin, we can demo. That means you have to take the serum from a suspected individual and inject into the two mouse. One acts as a test, another acts as a control animal. So the control animal has to be given polyvalent antitoxin 1 hour before giving the toxin, and another test animal has to be given as it is. If the control animal is not, the control animal survives after injection of the toxin, that indicates the toxin which is present in that particular serum is botulinum toxin. And this is not commonly being done, only for research purpose people will do. But the ELISA method is available to demonstrate the toxin from the food, feces, vomitors are from the serum. This is the commonest method being used. And PCR test also can be done to demonstrate the tox gene from the isolates. That means once you isolate the microorganisms from the clinical specimens, and these organisms to be subjected for PCR testing to detect the tox gene. The tox gene means the gene responsible for toxin production in the bacterium. And remember, whenever you would like to take the sample, don't take the formed or solid stool which is not useful. Always have to take semi-solid stool or water stool or diuretic stool only you have to collect from the patient. And microscopy of the stool, you can see the gram positive bacilli which are non-capsulated, motile with peritracheate, trichus flagella, and are having subterminal spores. The same morphological features you can see by growing the organisms on culture medium also. So on culture medium, culture media to be used are blood agar, RCM and egg agar. On blood agar, you can see large irregular semi-transparent colonies with fimbriate border. You can see the border on the end of the colony. That is due to the motile nature of this bacterium. And RCM, left side you can see RCM, meat particles may turn either into black or pink in color. And egg yolk agar forms iridescent film on colonies. Iridescence means, on left side again you can see, it's in a CD, the compact disc. If you expose the compact disc to the oblique light, you can see the different colors. That is known as iridescence. So the same way, if you expose the colonies which are growing on egg yolk agar medium, you can see the iridescent, that iridescence will be seen followed by exposure to the oblique light. And this bacteria can ferment the glucose and hydrolyze the gelatin. These are the two other important biochemical properties to identify this bacterium. And treatment and prophylaxis for the botulism. First, let me talk about the prophylaxis for the botulism. And whenever you have the wound, you have to be careful about the wound debridement. And the food, if any stored food is there, cook it by pressure cooking, not by simple heating. And whenever you would like to preserve the foods, preserve them at less than 4 degrees centigrade or more than 75 degrees centigrade. In between, especially the 35-40 or at room temperature, the contaminated food will allow the bacteria to multiply, which would be rich in toxin production, and consumption of this toxin may result in, otherwise called protoxin. Protoxin, consumption of this protoxin results in toxicity. One most important point to remember is the contaminated food with this bacterium will never show the signs of spoilage. That means the food looks normal, and thinking that the people will consume the food thinking that this is a normal food, because you can't see any signs of spoilage like smell or change of food consistency, nothing would be there. So people will think that it's a normal food. After consumption, the toxin which is present in that food may cause further clinical manifestations. And treatment of botulism, botulinum antitoxin to be given, and of course metronidazole or penicillin also can be given to kill this bacterium.